So we're talking about the area between 110th and 125th Street, from Riverside Drive to Morningside. So we are a neighborhood of institutions, and they've recently been able to sell buildings, air rights, and lots to the highest bidder, as developers see Morningside Heights as a target because we are an as-of-right zone, meaning that developers can build whenever they like, provided they obtain the air rights at very high costs and the land. So the institutions that make our neighborhood thrive, but at the same time are selling off a lot of the land in order to fund their endowments, in order to pay for rebuilding, and we'll get into some of that in a moment. So the current challenge is we have luxury overdevelopment without affordable housing. So they can build as high as they want and not provide any affordable housing. Non-contextual design. They can build any kind of design they want, any kind of architecture. We have no say, and there's no pipeline. As we know, when there's incredible increased density of 200 apartments per building, it puts stress on our infrastructure, on our transportation, on our schools, on our emergency services. The neighborhood is not compensated, and we need to somehow mitigate that situation as development continues. And as a result of the luxury development, we have a rising tax rate that affects everyone. And it especially will affect rising rents of long-time residents and mom-and-pop stores who've been here for years. And therefore, we're going to have rising displacement of long-time residents. So what is affordable housing? I'm not going to get into all of the details, but I just wanted to give you kind of a definition. It's defined as the area median income. And for New York City, right now, that's $95,400 for a family of four. These figures are from 2015, but I just selected because it shows the map of where we get those numbers from. It's not just the five boroughs. It's the northern areas in Westchester, which are disproportionately higher income than what we have. And so they've combined it to form the area median income. So when a developer faces mandatory inclusionary housing, it could mean, for example, that a portion of a building being built would be allocated as affordable, let's say 50% of the building, and let's say at 30% of the area median income. So for 30% of that would be around 30,000. If it was 50% would be around 45,000, something like that. So those are the different variables we're dealing with when we're talking about affordable housing. So I mentioned the institutions. So a while back, St. John the Divine decided to sell land, and this is the Avalon. This actually does have some affordable housing. We estimate that of the 1,200 units that are either going online or scheduled to go online in the next few years, only about 7% will be considered affordable, mostly in the Avalon and the other building built on the St. John the Divine land, the enclave. Now, for the land which is being rented, for the Avalon, St. John the Divine gets, I think, about $3 million a year, and for the enclave, about $2 million a year. Reverse, I'm not sure, but a lot of money for that, and they decided that they obviously needed the money like the other institutions decided that they needed to sell land and air rights. By the way, in the Enclave and the Avalon, and also in this building, which was sold by St. Luke's, it used to provide housing for nurses, the rents go from anywhere from between $3,000 for a studio or one bedroom, up to $7,000 for two bedrooms or three bedrooms. That's the going rate, market rate, for all of these new buildings. Certainly not affordable, certainly beyond the area median income. St. Luke's also sold these landmark buildings to a developer named Del Shah. They are restoring the facade and keeping it an historic facade, a landmark. They are gutting the interiors, and they're going to be creating luxury rentals. Again, not in the affordable range. And they're also going to be qualifying, they hope, for tax credits for restoring an historic building. So you may be wondering what the big construction site is all about next to JTS. Savannah is the developer. JTS sold a number of buildings along with air rights to Savannah. In return, JTS got approximately $96 million for the air rights and land, and then they, in addition, there were other buildings, it was several million dollars more. Again, there's no constraint on what Savannah can build, provided that they have the lot size and the air rights available to them. So what are they building? Well, this is a graphic presentation. As you can see, the ground portion is the existing JTS structure, and next to it is the building that JTS is building with some of the money that they got from the sale of the air rights and land. They're going to be building a library and an auditorium. But next to that is the Savannah building called the Vanderwater, and that will be all luxury condos between $2 and $5 million with a swimming pool, garage, and by the way, a pet spa. A pet spa. Yes, you heard me. So this is another presentation of what it might look like. A long time ago, we actually saw a picture of what the projected building will look like. The picture we saw was poured concrete, kind of resembling Riverside Church's look and feel, they said. This happens to be a glass representation. Here's another one. So you can see it's out of context. Would you agree? Laura mentioned that JTS also sold some other buildings. This was a charming building on 120th Street that had been a residence hall, and the Orbach Group bought it and is building a 15-story luxury rental at that site. This building has been demolished. UTS sold air rights, and they're going to be building a 40-story tower on the corner of the campus. This is the developer Ron Merlis of L&M, together with the very big company Lend-Lease. UTS sold the building, the land area, the right to use, and the air rights for $100 million. They need the money to rebuild Union Theological Seminary and to create an endowment, of course. So we've been communicating with the developers, with the heads of the institutions, talking about their plans, asking them to try to mitigate a lot of the stress that these buildings will cause, and obviously trying to get them to change some of their architecture and building height. When we talk about zoning specifically, that is something that zoning could remedy. Will it be bigger than, will it be higher than Riverside Church? Riverside Church is 392 feet. Yes, it will, because it's a 40-story building. So this is a great representation, but you can see roughly what it might look like. So we haven't mentioned yet the 800-pound lion in the room, Columbia. Columbia keeps its plans pretty secret, and obviously they've been focused on the Manhattanville campus for many years now. But we think they will start turning their attention again to Morningside. And they have a history of tearing down some townhouses and leaving empty lots. This is an example of an empty lot owned by Columbia. They could choose to build whatever they want on there, given that they obtain air rights. And so you could have a mid-block, 30-story tower there if they wanted to build a new dormitory, for example. We estimate that there are over 30 vulnerable sites that Columbia owns in the neighborhood. We're talking about a lot of the low-level buildings, mid-blocks, and some of the residence halls that are 8 stories high around the neighborhood. These are all vulnerable to overdevelopment because these buildings are difficult to maintain, many of them are run down. Columbia may just decide we don't want to bother with that anymore, we need something new, and they could do it. If we rezone, that would change things. Here's another example of Columbia's parking lot. We think that they're going to make a deal with St. Luke's and buy a building and then combine it to create at least a 20-story building there. They could do it. So why is everyone so outraged? Well, because, for example, I think you're familiar with these buildings in the neighborhood below us. These are the area east and west. These are Excel developed buildings. When these buildings went up, it outraged the neighborhood. There was no zoning there. After they went up, this is again a while ago, it was a different administration, a different city planning administration, and Gale Brewer and others were able to impose a limited zoning plan, so there will be other buildings like this in that neighborhood. However, we don't have that protection, and that's what we're trying to do. Some of you were here at the same site last year where we held a visioning workshop, where we heard all your concerns about the neighborhood, and we documented it in a report called Morningside Speaks. It's a 57-page report. It talks about the neighborhood, and it documents a lot of the stories you had to say, and it's been distributed to lots of the politicians as well as to city planning. Some of the headlines that came out of that report, Morningside needs to preserve small town environment, infrastructure, maintain quality of life. Truly affordable housing needed to promote diversity. Schools are overcrowded, yes, because of additional stress on the neighborhood. Need new schools. Prices are soaring, middle class is being squeezed out. We need arts funding. We have green space opportunities. We need to rezone to promote contextual development and limit building heights. This is what came out of the workshop. This is what people said that they wanted. Transportation need upgrades. There are no elevators in the subways for disabled or senior citizens. The tall towers actually are robbing us of light. And the mom and pop stores are disappearing. And by the way, we are also very concerned about construction safety as these developments go up. And not only the safety of pedestrians and longtime residents who walk by there all the time, but construction workers. There's been a lot of problems, a lot of deaths actually from in construction work lately. The numbers are rising. So please, if you haven't had a chance when you're on your way out, please see Kyle Haver, who's head of the Health and Safety Committee, who's done a fantastic job. He's back there documenting a lot of the construction problems. He has pictures and video, and you can actually go to our Facebook page that's devoted to this and see. And some of this is really incredible that they are, you know, basically they're untethered. They're throwing asbestos around. I mean, it's remarkable. So anyway. And the Morningside Speaks report, please go to our website, morningsideheightscommunitycoalition.com. Go to reports, click on that, and you can download the entire report. So, before we get to Barry, I just want to sum up the urgency here of rezoning Morningside Heights. We need to improve infrastructure and social services to meet the needs of a displaced population. As luxury development occurs, long-time residents will be displaced, they need representation, they need to know what their issues are and what their rights are. We are in favor of development, reasonable development, with height limits, with affordable housing. We're not against all development. We want to promote contextual development. We'll be mostly on the side streets and avenues specifically. And then finally, rezoning will accomplish, if we do it right, it will enforce mandatory inclusionary housing in a rezoned Morningside Heights. So that's the end of my presentation. Before I turn it over to Barry, who's going to again give you an overview of zoning and then a block by block view of rezoned Morningside Heights. Does anybody have some questions that they want about the current state of overdevelopment? Yes, sir.
Where, which building is the Avalon, please?
The Avalon?
Yeah.
The Avalon is the building that is next door to St. John the Divine, on Morningside Drive and 110th Street. 110th Street, yes. Yes.
What did you say the median area income was?
The area median income is currently $95,400 for a family of four. Again, that includes the northern areas, Westchester counties.
But it's not the median area income.
So the area median income for Morningside Heights, depending on where you look, is approximately $65,000 to $70,000. If you go to East Harlem, it's approximately $30,000. Yes? So, is the height of the building at the Savannah site next to JTS and the Union Theological determined? They have announced the heights of those buildings. But let me add, we actually mounted a zoning challenge to try to limit the height of the Savannah building next to JTS. We had a few reasons to do this. It was a very convoluted deal that they made. Joining various lots and using open space in a way that really went against the zoning regulations. Unfortunately, the Department of Buildings did not rule in our favor. We feel that part of the problem is that they're not enforcing zoning regulations. So we're not the first to face a denial of a zoning challenge. And so we tried to limit the height. We have not been successful at doing that yet. Okay. Any other questions?